I'm back, bitches!
Okie dokie, gentlemen, are we all here ready to fucking go? I asked y'all a question!
As I reveal my giant monkey!
That's not as funny as you thought it was, boy!
Y'all, I thought it meant penis!
I swear, the only thing I hate more than weaklings...
Hey! I'm speaking, soldier! Don't fucking speak unless you're smart to fucking... What we're gonna do is we're gonna fly over the bird.
The talk show at the end of the week.
Space is big.
Star Citizen.
It's really big.
Round table.
What? Hi. Hello. Welcome to the round table.
Yay.
Welcome, bots and bobbits.
Hello, bots. All the algorithms are working perfectly.
Yes. I am bot. Hello.
Another okay. Week. Still no Star Citizen. Disgraceful.
What?
Wait.
I thought it was out by now. Still out. Actually, 3.17.2 just got... wasn't it yesterday that they went to...
No, I thought it was today.
Wave 2, and now today it went to all backers. Yeah.
Oh, did it go just public?
Just now, maybe hours ago.
I think they're trying to do some testing, isn't it?
The large scale
they're bringing
testing,
in numbers.
Player numbers, yeah.
So they can screw the whole thing up.
But it never really tells you if they're close or not, because sometimes this public PTU stays up for another week or two.
That's
because it finds all the problems, right? Because of the volume of players.
If there are problems, yeah.
But we did get a rough confirmation from the two head honchos themselves.
Yeah, as if they know exactly. They don't have control over if issues may appear that they haven't foreseen.
If they said it, it's going to happen, right?
Yes. It's going to happen. Yeah, yeah, sure, okay. Yeah, I've seen that. This is a thing with events, though, and I'm actually kind of sad for these for them, because obviously there will be people that are going to try and get them to say something exclusive or something that, you know. So is 3.17.2 going to be close? Oh, is it? Yes, they have the answer
hopefully
to that, of course.
No more than 7 to 10 days out. So I expect it by the end of next weekend. Hello, I'm God. This is my brother.
You're God?
No, he's God. He's introducing himself. So he's saying, hello, I'm God. This is my brother.
Oh, okay.
We're part of Jesus.
The thing that I noticed first and foremost is how much weight Aaron has lost. Fair play.
He looks good.
He does. Like, he really was a beach ball.
Was he?
Not too
long. Wow, that's not very nice.
But he was. He was quite unhealthy because he was quite skinny. And then out of nowhere, he put on a ton of weight.
Work stress.
You talked the same thing about Ben.
Well, Ben has underlying conditions, unfortunately. He's a very large person. Like, he's very tall and he has conditions. So, unfortunately, you know, that could lead to other things. But this was quite surprising that he put on a lot of weight, and now it's good to see that he's taken it off again. He looks better overall, because he was quite ill looking. And they look happy-ish, apart from the bags underneath their eyes, but we'll ignore that.
That's England.
I don't know why they have bags under their eyes. It's not like they do any work. They're just in the Caribbean spending all of our money.
That's tiresome. You should know that. You keep doing that all the time as well. You know how tiresome that is.
I mean, I appreciate the support of the Caribbean islands, but how else are they going to maintain tax havens?
Well, they have to do it somehow. Well, you know, the COG have to, you know, make their profits through the Cayman Islands. So we won't talk about that too much. So yeah, anybody still tried to beat you or not bothering or any of us have to blame you? You always
not bothering.
No, I tried a little bit. Actually, the last time I jumped on seemed to be a little bit more stable. But when I checked out the Centurion, that looks pretty.
Yeah, looks a bit of fun. Nothing really special, though.
No, I mean, if you have it in tandem with the missile variant, I forget what it's called.
Ballista.
The Ballista. They make a deadly combination.
What do you do? Well, they're definitely ideal for an outpost or even Jumptown. You know, put a few of them around Jumptown and...
oh my god, ugly tiling. Yeah. Dexter's tiling. What the fuck?
But that's what moons and planets have, Roland. Yeah, you know?
Yeah, it's alien, yeah.
Really,
it's a pattern.
Yeah, God made it.
Aliens made it.
Whoever took the picture just doesn't have skills. That's all.
Actually, this is morphologist footage is always super,
there you go.
Super good. I love his cinematography. Just, I don't know if he does it or someone else does it for him, but this is, he always has very nice shots. Look at that. Just look at that. It's cool. But yeah, we talked about this last week. You weren't here though, but yeah.
Yeah, you were busy in real life. How dare you?
It was not by choice.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So yeah, we talked about that last week. Not much we can go into there. There's nothing really new.
But what did you guys suspect the price to be?
What's the price of the Ballista? It was 140, wasn't it? So
yeah,
120, 140. I expect to be exactly the same.
Probably yeah,
maybe slightly 140, less. Yeah, it's not missiles. Missiles are usually a bit more kick to it. But still, it's four size, four guns, and a nice size tree in the front. So that can be quite formidable. I say 140. Yeah, I'll go for the same price, 140.
Yeah.
Or they may drop at the price just to get more people to buy the thing. CIG seem to be very generous in their pricing lately. Oh, it works. If you can get it at a more affordable costing, more people will buy the bleeding thing. It's probably why they're doing well. Yes, I saw this.
They could do this with it.
This was fun, yeah.
Well, what did you...
Launch objects. So if
off of what? What was it on top of?
It was a plate, some kind of metal
plate on top of it, yeah.
And they put it on top of the tank?
The barrel.
Right on top of the barrel, yeah. And so they fired the gun. And, yeah.
Surprise, it actually works.
Not really. No,
it doesn't just shoot through it. That would be...
Well, yeah, I suppose. I suppose in the real world, it would be a metal plate and... It would actually probably damage the barrel and probably explode where you are. I wonder if you can put a grenade on that and then launch the grenade.
explode in the sky.
But yeah, good to see. That'll be a bit of fun. Wonder, can you pick up a player and then put him from the...
A dead body, yeah. Actually,
A dead body. Put the real thing there. Put a player on there.
That's exactly what they did next.
They did put a body.
Oh, they did it.
Didn't go very far, did it?
No, it's probably it was too rubbery. At least, like, the metal plate would just be a solid piece. This thing would probably flap around and interfere with it.
Lost all its kinetic energy.
Yeah.
The flesh just absorbed it all.
The rubber.
Rubber body. Just loose. Everything's just loose. If it was solid, if it was just T-posing, then I guarantee you, you'd probably get further.
You mean the skeleton?
What else did they test? They probably tested boxes or something like that.
Did you see that in some of the patch notes it listed LODs disabled, decoupled lighting on lower planetary effects LODs?
So I'm trying to figure out what exactly is that.
I don't know either, but it's a temporarily disabled.
we've seen dozens of these over the past few years as CIG's graphic quality is just slowly and surely getting worse and worse, just to compensate to get higher FPS. We have to keep an eye on all this, because CIG probably might be too comfortable with this lower graphics. I wouldn't be. One of the reasons why I backed the thing was for the next generation of graphics.
So just to add yours to the other list of disgruntled backers.
But I paid X amount of money into the game, you know?
So did they. Pixels.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be too stupid to remind them about some of these facts and to check if they actually did put them back in. If they say temporarily disabled, who's going to check that they actually put it back in afterwards?
I think that's a good idea. I think you should do a post like that of listing them off, of, you know, how things have deteriorated over the years, and are CIG planning to bring them back at some point?
Maybe they already have. Maybe they've not noticed it, but...
Well, we're still seeing those stupid tiling anyway.
Yeah.
And of course, the global lighting still hasn't been fixed yet.
Give it time. We're still working on Gen 12.
No. Don't give it time, Riot.
Yeah, I'm getting old. I'm starting to wear nappies.
So we're still in the Foundation Festival thing, right? Did I talk about this last week? I'm not even sure.
Well, I thought it was last week.
I thought that was done on the 15th. Just the free fly?
25.
That's the free fly.
That's the free fly, yeah.
No, the Foundation Festival ends 25th, I think.
25, yeah.
Yeah. Really, it should be permanent, but... Yeah, went into detail, but we never really tried it until this week, didn't we? So.
No, but I mean, like, did I mention back then all the weird flaws with the guide system? I was like, because over time, I just... And eventually, I just the only reason I still wanted to use it was just to get the rewards. And in the beginning, I was like, "Oh yeah, cool, maybe I could help some people." But that's quickly went away when you just realize some of these things, how the guide system works momentarily, and some of the things that you actually don't even know as a guide about how it works that you should have been told. Which is just so weird. Like, for one, the system is so weird currently, and I mean, I'm anxious to see when they do hand out these rewards after the event ends, how many people might come back and start making rant posts on Spectrum about the fact that they should have gotten X reward but weren't, because, and they probably don't know that the backer probably just doesn't get that information about why they might have not gotten it, even though they think they might have done a guide session to be to have obtained that. So I'm wondering if that I feel like that could happen, because the information out there about the official information out there about how the guide system works is so vague that it is very easy to construe guide sessions and think that you've done the right thing while in fact you did nothing at all, or you did it not in the proper way, or and a lot of that is in the hands of even the person you're teaching, the student, so to say, as well, because they have to fill out a survey afterwards to endorse your session. And you don't really know if they're going to do that or not, unless you point it out to them, which is something that again, you as a guide, you don't even know that they have to do that. So you can't point it out to them if you don't have that information, which CRG doesn't give you. So, and it's all in all, it's weird.
Yeah, it wasn't laid out. The rules weren't laid out early on properly, I think. They did adjust the system, but still, I do expect a lot of salt from the forums, on Spectrum at least, anyway, after the 25th, because a lot of people are going to be disappointed. We're still not sure how CIG are monitoring this.
That was mentioned on that post, but I don't think they do even have an actual monitoring system other than maybe automated system that might detect massive amounts of guide sessions coming in to a single person. That is clearly not possible using maybe accounts that are bots or secondary accounts that he's made. But other than that, people even within, when I've been doing some of these guide sessions throughout the week with just random people, even some of these people are very careful about what they do because they think they might get flagged because CID said that they were monitoring the system. But I don't really think that they're doing that at all, other than maybe some automated, like I said, maybe some automated detection system for extreme cases. But other than that, I don't think that they're going to check whether or not you went in game. Because the only thing after a session ends is that the student gets the question, did you go in game? And you have to answer it with yes. And are CRG going to then check that you actually went in game? You know how much work that would be?
Well, not really. They can look through the data and say, okay, well, those two were in the same game, same session, same server with each other, so. And they can probably see the time that they're with each other. So,
yeah, but that's work.
Yeah, it is that work. Do they have the manpower to look after it properly?
I mean, I don't know how large the active community is and how many people have been. I mean, Zylo did say there's a lot of people using it since the beginning of Foundation Festival, but like I seriously doubt that they have the manpower and even the time to do that.
I'm trying to figure out what is the purpose of this, really. Because, well, you would think that the whole purpose of this is to actually train people, particularly new people, and the subtle nuances of this game. And really, all it is a bleeding must-have fest of I want the beanies, I want the skins, etc., etc. That's all it's about, really. It's not about the teaching.
Well, they made it like that because they... because they probably wanted to promote this system more.
Well, it'd be better off having it on all the time.
The rewards?
If it has general purpose. Oh, we lost somebody.
Sorry, I wasn't paying attention to anything you guys were saying.
No,
you're talking
course,
about the reward system.
The guide system. The reward. But of course,
what's the point?
It is made. Exactly what you said, it is probably true. They initially made it so that they could could let backers help new players to learn the game. Because up until
because
now,
they can't do a tutorial.
Exactly. Up until now, they've failed to do that quite much. Because tutorials don't exist. Game tutorials, that is. They have some documentation in text form on their support page, which is actually, it's okay. I think it might get people started, but you know how people are. They don't want to read. In fact, there's quite often, you even still during these free flies, you see people go in game and they're like in the global chat complaining about the fact that the game runs like crap. And then they ask them like, what kind of a system do you have? Oh yeah, I have a i5 with 8 gigs of RAM and I've installed the game on a hard drive.
There's a lot of people who have no choice, really.
Yeah, no, I get that, but the system requirements are still there. So, I mean, people might just try it anyway, but...
Yeah, they'll probably play something like Elite Dangerous, and I don't know what the system requirements there are, but, you know, it wouldn't be as much as Star Citizen. Anyway, Star Citizen is not optimized, so it doesn't matter what system you have.
No.
You could have the greatest system on the planet, and I guarantee you still run like shit.
It look like shit.
But yeah, so they would need
all the time
backers to help new players. Okay, cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, but in theory, it's a good idea. But
it's a good idea. But as I said, it should be on all the time, not for a couple of weeks every year.
Yeah,
it's silly.
Yeah, that, and I think they are taking lots of notes. I'm pretty sure that they are going to try and develop this system further. Because right now it's just so weird. Because from a perspective of a guide, it's even unclear. Because you join as a guide, and there's some documentation on the official side support page about how it works. But there's not enough information in there about what you're supposed to do. So when you go in like that, which is what I did initially, it's basically just a matchmaking service at this point inside Spectrum and nowhere else. At least we have the functionality right now that Spectrum friends on that website translate over into the game, so they're your friends in game right away, so that makes it easier to then join their game. But other than that, there's no real connection in the system with the game, which is kind of sad, because so you go in as a guide and you don't even know really what you're supposed to do, because all you get is when you get a hit of a guy that wants your help, it initiates a PM session, like a private message session in Spectrum on the website. You know, you automatically get a friend invite, and that works. But then what you're supposed to do, I don't know. So what about talk? Explain him how the game works.
The first thing I'd do is invite him to a Discord channel, so therefore you don't have to waste your time typing.
Yeah, well, maybe that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure. Do CIG monitor Spectrum and they have a quick look at that session going, oh, those two.
They must realize that people do that. Yeah. Even the fact that when you go in game, people often then use the in-game chat. So there's no way to say that, oh, they're not talking on Spectrum, so they didn't do anything. Because they might have been chatting in game, which is what a lot of people do.
So I'm going to admit it, right? So you and I had a session, and it was actually a legit session because we were learning refueling. So we actually went into the game. We spent about, what, an hour and a half trying to figure out the the refueling of the Starfarer, which was hilarious, and all its subtle nuances. So I wonder, will that now get any kind of ranking? Will they say, oh, hang a second, they're friends. Maybe they're scheming together.
No, I don't think they've... They said that before.
No, I gave myself the ranking because I have alt accounts. I just gave myself ratings and it works. it's an automated system. They're not looking at it at all.
Yeah, like I said, this is what I hear quite a lot, even when I talk to other random people that I've had guide sessions with. Like, they're so afraid that CCG might pick up on some weird stuff they're doing. And I don't think that's I don't think you should worry at all. It's just that they're not going to check all that stuff. They don't have the power or manpower to do that. Nor can they assume that stuff like the fact that you don't talk in Spectrum means that you're not doing anything. And stuff like other, and there's lots of other stuff like that. Yeah, you just can't just assume that someone's messing about and not doing anything.
I mean, you don't even need to be in the game.
Well, that's what I assume, at least. But although other people say, "Oh yeah, we should go in game and get into a party, just to make sure." Yeah, okay, I get that.
You don't. You just need to spend 30 minutes in a session, and it gives you a credit.
How'd you know?
I gave myself all the rewards.
Have you got the rewards?
Oh, no. Well, you don't have them yet.
Not this time for the, but all the badges I've given myself.
Other ones, yeah.
Oh, you get badges? Ooh.
Those were the original, the system was in place already. The badges existed before Foundation, this little phase.
Oh, wait, hang on a sec. I never even checked, though. Is that there now? Or do I have to wait to the end?
To get the badges?
You might already get them right away, yeah. Just look on the wiki. There's a titles page. There's a list of all of them.
Let's go to my profile. Let's see.
These. There's like a ton of them for every rank. Oh, TM, you gave yourself all these badges. But there's other ranks, so you need to collect them all. You need to do 150 guide sessions in every different category to earn these.
No, I haven't given myself the gold ones yet. I don't think they were that extensive. It was just three when I did it. It was like 5, 10, 15,
I don't understand
like that,
how guide sessions. I don't even understand how they could think that people would do that, other than maybe they just thought that if this guy, this system exists for 10 years, maybe someday people will hit 150. But
no, I can't see badges. So I definitely haven't got it yet. I'm not even sure I am going to get it. Not a creator.
Like I said, it's so weird as a guide. You do not get tools to go in game. So that's why I said, like, I just initially just chatted with them in Spectrum to explain how the game works and what different things you can do, mission types, whatever. Thinking that was okay, but it wasn't. Well, at least not in theory, because once the session is over, which I also didn't know, the other guy gets a question, did you go in game? Oh, if they answered truthfully and said no, that whole session was invalidated. Which technically should not really be the case, because you didn't go in game. That doesn't mean you didn't learn anything. I don't know why they want people to go in game. Per se. I don't know. It's weird.
All I know is there's going to be a massive salt fest.
Yeah, there will be. Like us, yeah.
Yeah.
So I did this X amount of sessions, and I should have these skins. Where are they?
Hey, follow.
I think that's something CIG consistently does wrong, where a company like Warframe does right. Because Warframe does the things where if you watch their Twitch stream every week, you just get a free something, some item in game. Normally it's insubstantial, but you get something. But if they ever have a mess up where like, it's not awarded properly or whatever. They just give everybody who was viewing their stream, because it's normally like you have to watch for an hour or something, right? But they just give everybody who viewed the stream the item and say, "Our fuck up, my bad. Anybody who even tried, here you go. Here's the free thing."
Oh, it's clear that, I mean, if you think about it like that, it's kind of clear that CIG already fucked this up, because the way that I've gone through this week with this guide session just shows you that it's just not very clear at all.
Yeah, I mean, especially if you're trying to encourage players being your tutorial system, you don't want to disincentivize them by saying, oh, you didn't meet our arbitrary criteria. Sucks to suck. Thanks for all the free time you spent teaching players to play our game.
Yeah, well. Other than those weird things, there's even, like, I noticed that it would have, and this is probably why I said that they're probably taking notes to improve this system, and I hopefully that will happen, because if at least if they want to continue this, because like I said, you even from a perspective of already being in game, there's no way for you to properly, if you might have encountered someone through other means other than Spectrum or through this guide system, it is very hard to then find each other in this guide system. Like, oh, I'm on Discord with you, and I'm saying, oh, would you do a guide session with me to learn you about X and X? Yeah, sure. Let me just find you on the guide hub. But how? There's no search function there. People can't find each other other than, you know, picking some obscure language as your on your profile, which then filters the results, so you can pick a language that nobody uses, so you can find the other person. That's usually how they do that now, which is kind of convoluted because there's no other way to find each other. The same thing is, like, from a perspective of being in game. You're in game. The global chat is often is often being used for people that, you know, don't understand something, want to ask a question, there's a bug or something. Yeah. And in some cases it might be like, oh yeah, I can help you. Would you like to start a guide session? Oh yeah, sure. But once again, how do you do that?
It's just as quick to say, hop on Discord, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, it doesn't incentivize the usage of this system at all.
No.
Yeah, so it's weird. It's weird at this point. Which is why I said last time, like, oh yeah, it's cool that they're putting in rewards for this, because it makes them promote the system more. But on the other hand, it's weird that they're putting in these rewards, because the system has so many issues that you can't really put these rules on top of it and expect people to use it fairly. But now we're just going really deep into into this. It's just,
well, yeah, this is a
realm. This is what I've just gone through within the past week. It's just stupid, actually, but whatever.
It has potential. I think it's a good idea, but yeah, CIG, I expect, need to take notes.
And I expect this guide system to die after this week anyway, after this whole phase.
Well, it is. It only ends on the 25th. That's the stupid thing about it.
Yeah, it's for sure dead.
Dead.
Yeah. It needs to be permanent.
How can it be the one if he's dead?
And that leads to other things, like, why don't CIG have a decent voice chat? You know, we're not going to do everything in-game. That's just silly.
I think in-game voice is dumb. Like, nobody uses in-game voice.
Well, no, for proximity.
I've seen people do it, but yeah. It's...
Meet a stranger and stuff like that. There's no way you can talk to each other right away.
Yeah. So again, you have to go to another third-party app. So CG need to do something to try to keep it in-house, but the current setup is just messy. The chat's messy.
I mean, this would be a great opportunity for them to put about a month's worth of dev time into Arena Commander. No, and then you can say start a guide session, and it launches like a private Arena Commander session between the two of you.
Well, I believe that's...
That makes sense.
That's something like that is actually planned, where you can actually start private sessions. but not like that. But that's a good idea, though.
Like, you could, because I know they were talking about, and I think they should support, like Arena Commander and Star Marine as like games within the game kind of thing. Especially, which I don't think they're going to do, but especially if they ever bring back long quantum travel times, like giving people the ability to play in Star Marine while you are quantuming would be a great like distraction and keep people happy. But yeah, just like even in universe, being able to say like start a guide session and it boots up the quote unquote simulator and you guys can fuck around without repercussions of like having to pay insurance fees or like worrying about going to jail because you're teaching somebody how to dogfight or whatever.
Well, yeah, that was the whole idea of Arena Commander. It's supposed to be the trainer. It's supposed to train you without, you know, wasting any resources.
Right, just put it in game is what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know why they really
have. You need server meshing for that, though, because it would, you'd have to spin up into a new server shard.
Wasn't there something about that, Joe, this week? About news about...
Todd Poppy was on Star Citizen Live, so he was...
Because they were talking about ships. Or somewhere they saw that they were talking about ships that you bought in the PU that should be brought into being available in the Arena Commander as well, which currently obviously isn't the case. Everything in there is still pulled from your account only.
There was a dev reply. I was like these little dev replies in Spectrum. Somebody talked about Arena Commander. I don't know if you've seen that there. I think it's in the middle of the list.
Is there still a dev tracker right somewhere?
Here we go. Here, post it for you. It was mostly about Vandal Swarm and Pirate Swarm. With a little bit of Star Marine.
Oh, yeah. Well, there were some things that they assumed that wasn't the case, because shooting range. How many times have we talked about that? Like, this could be going off of the reel, but when the social module Arcorn was made,
you don't have the resources to create a box with targets at the end of it.
No, they have it. We've seen them use it. It's every time we saw them on their AT, their Around the Verse shows or Inside Star Citizen.
Yeah, but it's always in white box.
They
never finish it.
It was a really dirty shooting range, but yeah. But ever since the social module was made, we were in Arcorp. Even since then, we've been saying that, because there was a shooting range.
There's actually a shooting range on the Idris and the Javelin.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So unless they're deliberately holding back.
There's a shooting range in Grimhex. There's a shooting range in Area 18. It's just that their doors are locked. You can't get into them.
No, there's nothing there.
Even players access to the commander ships on the ships they bought in PU. Not planned at the moment.
So they've admitted Vandal Swarm is easier than Pirate Swarm.
Yeah.
But they're planning to fix that soon. So if you want to get your token for your glaive, now is the time.
Yes.
Simple yes or no question.
Right.
Which probably we can lead then to Star Citizen Live, where, as I said, we had Todd Pappy. So Todd is one of those few people that the backers do pay attention to.
Oh, yeah.
What he says. And he gave a few interesting things.
Combat logging.
Combat logging, yes.
Yeah, they can't really ignore that anyway, and he did talk about it. Which then sparked another discussion on Spectrum, I think. I don't really see the problem with it anyway, though. I mean, the only reason that I might still occasionally need that instant logout when you Alt F4 is because for some issue you fall down, like you've been pushed out of the elevator. The elevator pushes you out of the building and you fall to your death. That sometimes occurs.
I think it's legit to combat log if you've been hit by a major bug. I think it's legit to do that.
Yeah. Never legit. Kill them all.
But yeah, when the game's eventually fixed,
Say anything about how they were planning on doing that? Probably not.
Here. Did you not look at the whiteboard I posted? You never seem to read them.
He can't read.
Don't make fun of him.
I seem to do everything for you. Here. Click on that and pay attention.
Click.
Somebody very conveniently put it on the Twitter.
This just says, yes, eventually it will be addressed. Whoop-de-doo.
No, but he goes into more detail than I.
Yeah? Does he?
Yeah, I'm watching it again.
I don't think he does, though. But didn't he speak about the fact
you have to wait another 5 minutes before you can log out or something like that?
Isn't that a bit insane? You should be out of combat for 5 minutes for you to be able to log out instantly.
Maybe, yeah. I think if, but how do you tell between combat and non-combat?
Yeah, and that's another question.
You get shot. Had. That's easy.
Yeah, but that if that was the case, TM, that would still mean that people could combat log if they even encounter someone that they think they can't kill. They're like, oh shit, I'm fucked, and they haven't even shot yet. They just combat log.
Yeah.
Which can still happen if they did it that way. It's like, oh yeah, the combat's measured by the fact that if you get hit, well, which is probably not a very good way to do it, but
the way that places like Eve do it, right, is your ship, when you log out in the middle of nowhere, warps to the middle of nowhere and then despawns. I realize, well, small ships will despawn in Star Citizen, but I realize persistent ships aren't like that. But they could do the same thing where if you log out, your ship still has to physically fly into the middle of nowhere on autopilot or whatever. So if people can interdict you in time, then they can interdict you in time, and combat logging just makes your ship sit there like an idiot for 20 seconds or whatever.
So, timer.
Well, it's not, I mean, it is a timer, but the fact that you log out, your ship doesn't disappear if there are people in range. It flies away and disappears once there's no one in range. And if someone is hunting you, then they can, on foot, then you just yeah, if it's a safe zone, it's you disappear instantly. But if you're not in a safe zone, then it's a 10 second or a 20 second timer.
It's kind of like that in everywhere, really, no? Wow.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy. Yeah.
Rest zone, it's log out. Not in a rest zone, 30 seconds or something, yeah, 20.
Yeah, and I mean, people still combat log in open world PvP and WoW with a 10 second or 20 second timer, but that means you have to break line of sight and actually hide for that amount of time, so.
Shadow melt.
Yes, fucking spamming a button before they get around the corner, but.
Yeah, it's. I don't. Okay. You can speculate all sorts of ways they might do it, but it's, you know, it's not clear at all.
I mean, there's no way to prevent combat logging 100%. It's going to happen.
Yeah. Does the nav mesh allow, new nav mesh allow AI to use ground vehicles and fire on ships from on foot? No.
Yeah, answer everything in a yes or no.
But there is a plan for that.
Of course there's a plan. There's always a plan.
No, there's always a plan.
You're a plan.
What kind of stupid... I'm sorry. It's, you know, I may say those are stupid questions, but why would you ask this? Will you patch all the known bugs in 3.17.2 before going live?
That's a negative, Ghost Rider.
Ask that question, then, but they may never...
They will never patch all the bugs.
They don't know how this works, but okay. It's... It's fun.
Are you going to approve the FPS AI? Yes, 3.17.2 contains 6 months worth of network changes to reduce desyncing and decouple AI performance from server health, which we are tuning as necessary.
Yeah, okay. Is everybody else thinking the same thing? Like, yeah, okay, we'll see. We'll see it when it actually when we actually see it. And until then, I wouldn't bet on that. Actually, I'm sure they're doing work, but you know, you never know if that will actually improve anything.
Here's a surprise: will Crusader Reclaimers, the derelicts have loot boxes and not yet, which I thought was quite surprising.
The what? Where is that?
Yeah, the Reclaimer derelicts.
Oh, those, yeah.
Won't have loot boxes. So what's the point of going to them?
Yeah, well, we've been asking that question with the river, too. Which probably, like, again, it's just like they had it ready. We put in game, but there's no real use for them yet. Other than
shooting
NPCs, trying to hold it, role playing, maybe. Who knows? Okay, so they don't have loot boxes. Yeah.
So, Realm, I think you got involved in this. What do you think of Todd Pappy? Seemed to be happy with the constant delaying of patches when they come out.
Who?
When the patches, you know, they're always late. Was it Todd Pappy said this? I thought it was.
Well, you're just putting Todd Pappy's name on blast and you don't even know if he said it. I'm pretty sure that's defamation.
Somebody said it on Spectrum. Where is it? Bring it out here.
Was it?
Just straight up defaming this man.
Oh, the from Lethality, yeah.
So, you know, as all the patches are now seem to be permanently delayed. CIG seems to be all right with this. That everything seems to be missing their quarter mark.
No, but it's not what this threat is about.
Was it not? I thought that was about.
No, that was on some random shit from some dude on Twitter who mentioned that the fact that 318 was supposed to take 3 months of testing Evocati, you know, due to all these new systems. And okay, yeah, we get that. We've heard that. And he says, technically already a month into that cycle of 3 months, and we are still on 317.2. We don't have 3.18 and testing at all. And was it Joran? Yeah, you know, the
one dev that responds.
No, it's not dev, Joran.
No, Joran, the jump
citizen, bar citizen guy, what? White Knight.
Oh, yeah.
Said, also, I don't want to quote him, but he said, quote, "We are exactly where we are in the patch cycle as we have seen for 2+ years. Literally every quarterly patch doesn't release until well into the month after that quarter." Basically, normalizing the fact, making it okay, but normalizing the fact that some of these quarterly patches have never really been out before the end of that quarter at all for some time. Which is kind of like saying, like, okay, we're okay with you doing that. Which may some people, which in truth, maybe some people do not mind that. But I do, you know, and on the other hand, you do wonder what that means for future patches after that, and after that, and after that.
And another one. And another one.
So, I mean, if CIG tells us that these quarterly patches are going to be, you know, easier to hit, when they made this system, wasn't that why the reason why they did that, to stagger the development into two phases, so that the one team was one patch and then they could do the quarterly patches that way, to make it easier for them to hit that quarterly update.
Again, does this not have? Is this not to do with, again, Squadron 42 taking up all the resources?
Probably, but yeah, we don't know that.
They did warn us about this, you know, to be honest, that the next year,
all right, yeah,
might be not as fruitful as we hoped, because, as I said, Squadron is the priority. And so it's taken up everything.
Yeah, but it's just a phase of lack of large content updates in the PU patches that might not have anything to do with the timing of the patch releases. I don't know. Maybe both.
No, they definitely need more people. They don't have them, simple as that.
They need 1,000 devs.
Networking people.
Million IT. Devs, yeah.
Over 9,000
engineers. I just found it weird that you would normalize the fact that these patches have been, you know, technically late for every single time.
I mean, things take
time,
a long, but
which you shouldn't really do. I mean, it's still late. You shouldn't normalize the fact that it's be like, okay, whatever. Because then, you know, the bar gets moved. You do have to keep them to some.
A patch is never late, nor is it early. It arrives precisely when it means to.
Yeah, when it's ready, yeah. Now, the lethality post was, it's kind of interesting, though, because it was about, I would have to read everything, but he wrote it based after this recent Star Citizen Live episode with Todd, in which he noticed that this isn't necessarily bad, because plenty of new players coming in and not realizing what kind of game Star Citizen is intended to be even when it's completed, And Todd on SCL talked about a few points that fit the recent debate around here. Saying that the both answers, in his opinion, only clouded the view into a couple of these hot topics because it either means the players are completely misinterpreting the messaging, or CIG is changing their plans without communicating them. On, for instance, topics like...
The answer is yeah.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, yeah. But for instance, on topics like atmosphere, where they were talking about this lowering of the atmosphere level in Crusader, so it takes less time for you to fly up, which is a nuisance for everybody going there, especially with larger ships. But Lethality says here, and he doesn't give the source of where this came from, but I think it is true when he says, we've been told before that the heights on other planets are temporary, meaning that it will eventually go away anyway. And he asks, so is this the case here too? Which is why he thinks that people asking that question is kind of weird, because eventually it would go away anyway. And they didn't even hit on that in the Stars Isn't Life. What is the plan, basically, his question?
Regarding heights, so like they want you to jump right into the city. Is that what he means? Sorry.
No, he says that the atmosphere height was eventually going to go away. And I don't know where he doesn't say where he got this from, but he says we've been told before the other heights are temporary.
I don't understand.
But the atmosphere heights.
So
the limits from quantum travel.
Oh, no, there has to be something. You can't simply jump right into the city or jump out straight from the city. There has to be some kind of zone first. No, the thing about Crusader is that people need to realize that you have to adjust it. So this is where the space stations are needed. So you jump to your space station and then you leave your ship there and then you go down by shuttle or something else. That's what needs to happen. But it's just not in game yet. I think those Crusader shuttles should be going up from Orison, up to Port Olisar.
Yeah, maybe those can be a lot faster.
But when we have actually air traffic control space, you know, going up and down from these major centers is going to be much more restrictive than it is now.
Yeah. The PU, like they always said, the PU is 90% NPCs, 10% players. But currently, it isn't even close to that, because if they cram thousands of NPCs, ships in and around Crusader, shuttling people to Port Olisar and back, the server's dead, obviously. That is intended, because there's going to be so much activity around these ports constantly. There should be a lot of activity.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And some of them that even are useful to the player themselves, like the ferry taxiing services that you can use. His post was basically more to make a more general point, though. He says, all of this to say, I don't think a Q&A format at this point is of any value whatsoever. Players have no vision into the current thinking, so how can they ask intelligent questions? And if the answers aren't going to come along with the current plan, then they really are of little value.
No. Well, yeah, he's right. They really do have little value. But it gives the false impression that, you know, CIG care and are dealing with your issue, basically. But the reality is, you know, the players are just not realistic and not paying attention, actually, I think, to the long-term goal of the game. The 10-to-1 ratio, as you say, is one key issue that this it's supposed to be very busy and high traffic, and there's no way they're going to allow you to jump from a city or a port without going outside.
They 100% will.
Well, from a city.
Yeah, I think he's right for the wrong reasons. I think he's right that they will 100% remove them, but as far as I'm aware, they've only publicly said the opposite. But as with all cities, that they've had a larger quantum, like atmospheric barrier, they have lowered them because it's a game and it's not fun to just sit there for 15 minutes pointing in a straight line to get out of atmosphere. And it doesn't add anything to the game other than you're wasting 15 minutes. And when you have a aging player base, who most of which have professional jobs and can't play 12 hours a day like we could when we were 12, making a 15 minute time sink when someone might only be able to play for an hour a day is going to scare off your player base. So they're 100% going to remove all of those more pointless time sinks. I can see the argument for like long interplanetary quantum travel. I can we want to make that feel more distant, but that has some semblance of value, right? You could say like, well, by making it difficult to travel between two points, you make it more likely that you spend all of your time in one planetary system. And it's more like a home base. You like live there rather than traveling halfway across the galaxy to do a single mission and then halfway back, right?
It's a barrier it'll make sure that people don't do that as much at all because they know it's a waste of time, which makes them stay in place more. Yeah. I mean, it has a good effect.
And that has gameplay ramifications. Yeah. The fact that it takes 15 minutes to fly out of atmosphere is doing nothing but wasting people's time. There is no gameplay ramification.
Maybe it'll do the same thing at a smaller scale. It'll make sure that people stay on the planet.
Right, but traveling around the planet is even worse because you can only go quantum, or you can only go cruise.
I mean, like
speed.
With a vehicle.
Yeah, but like unless they're gonna somehow concentrate and like really push land missions, which. As last time I checked, this was not called the best damn land mission simulator ever.
Oh no! Yeah, but who
like,
knows? Maybe
if you're gonna say that they're gonna disincentivize space gameplay, they've now completely lost like the pill, because that's the whole point of this fucking game is that it's a space simulator, not a tractor simulator.
No, yeah, you're right. But you know, never know how they might think about this. I mean, they have the fact that they put in planets already tells you that. And all these gameplay things that they were planning to do for planets like bases and stuff like that. And who knows, maybe eventually there may be gameplay like chains that you do that just make you stay on the planet for quite a long time before you even go out. There might be lots of missions in and around a city.
I don't think there's anything wrong with having the option. I just don't think you, one, gain anything from a gameplay perspective, and two, make anybody happy by adding ridiculous atmosphere travel times. If I had to guess, it's going to be every atmosphere at maximum, you'll end up 20 to 30 kilometers away from the spaceport. Or maybe not the spaceport, but the landing zone in general. Because otherwise, it's not fun, and you're just disincentivizing people.
Why did they put this picture next to it? That's what I don't understand, but it's funny.
Well, Jared was quite tired, I think, for the whole show. He seemed kind of lethargic. I'm not sure if it was the weather or not.
It's always the weather. At least that's the excuse for Brits, right?
England. Just not used to it. Simple as that. So what else is there?
QA. Yeah, I can't
QA?
Going back to that freaking...
I don't know. Let's do the little the sharp bits then. So, subscriber vault.
Subscriber vault?
Did you see that?
No, I never really checked that.
Have a guess what it is.
Pictures.
Pictures of Pyro?
Pyro.
More basecaping. Oh, yay. These images I've seen before, no?
No.
Hang on, let me grab them.
They're not the best ones, I have to say. They seem to be very early stage with this.
This is white box. Put in an engine.
So I'm not sure if this is something new, because this is the... Well, it looks like an abandoned jump point. I'm not sure is it a working one.
Just you can see the Bengal. Space, yeah.
The Bengal's right in the middle here for size comparison.
And a Carrick.
Not the Bengal.
And a Carrick.
Yeah, Bengal. Where's Carrick? Where's Carrick?
There. And there's another one. Over there.
Where?
Enhance.
Oh God, hang on a second. I need to make your shit.
Look. Bigger. Right next to it. It's a clearly a Carrick shape.
Oh, it is Carrick. Sorry, okay.
And there, and there.
Know what it's just is. An asteroid. Just a fancy asteroid.
An asteroid in the shape of a Carrick, yeah, yeah, okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's a big structure. So I'm not sure, is that what we come true or not?
No, I think we just get to play around.
No, no, is this like the jump point that we come out of?
Yeah, but this could be something completely somewhere else. It does not necessarily is a jump point, though, right? I mean, no, it kind of looks like it, but...
It could be the abandoned jump point structure and stuff like that. You just come through the jump point, and it's there.
Actually, it does look like it. Okay.
Strange one.
Pictures.
I don't know why they showed that.
I'll tell you why, because they had nothing else.
So because they have nothing else. Everything again is squadron, and they won't show a squadron.
Although we got a sneak peek.
Le sneak peek.
Was.
Le sneak peek.
Le guns. And it's always funny how they show. I don't know what it is with those.
I'm rather confused.
The people
myself.
That make these images sometimes, they show combat.
So this is not
and
really great
clerical
promotion.
Clothing.
It's not great promotion for this gun, I have to say, when you have a player or NPC on the ground and they're trying to promote that gun, the vault. What was it? What was it called again?
Parallax,
yeah. I'm still confused. Is it electric gun or is it a laser?
It's a laser. Assault rifle.
Electrical. It's a big Zach.
Well, yeah, it is electron damage for sure, but I mean, is it? People always think that means that it's a stun gun or something, but it's there are already electron guns in the game that just kill you. It doesn't have to be a stun.
Yeah, they don't have the stun stuff yet. Then,
though, I don't even know if these guns are stun guns at all. These probably just kill guns.
Oh, you can probably adjust them. To just stun.
They never say
eventually. Well, they never say a lot of things, and we all assume stuff.
They could, yeah, you're right. It's
you know what they say about assuming.
They're two different guns. See that?
Yeah, one's a rifle, and one's a probably a
that one's loaded.
Shotgun.
That one's not.
No, see the long barrel. The one that has a huge long barrel. The other one's a short barrel. They're two different guns.
Yeah, they showed it in one of the Inside Star Citizens or something. It's the same manufacturer.
Yeah, but they look almost exactly the same, other than the barrel, slightly longer. Maybe that's reloading it. I don't know. It's still the same gun.
No, that's the other gun. There was two guns they had. I can't remember what was the name of the other one.
Oh, yeah.
I have to go into Star Citizen tools for this one.
Right, here. Palax rifle. Fresnel SMG. Doesn't have a picture, but it was mentioned.
So that's probably that other gun then. We need to zoom in and take a picture of that.
So this is the one.
The reason why those guys don't have armor and stuff like that is because they're in, an abandoned space station where people don't have any means.
Yeah, but they're in combat. Those people are wearing suits, I think, on the back.
It's gang wars. They don't look like they have suits on.
No, they look like they have suits on. So I can see a leg armor there and a guy in the middle. So you see the shine off it. His leg. His thigh there.
It's a flying grenade.
Grenades. I'm still afraid to moon.
I think everybody is. He's using them.
The people are using them now.
Yeah.
Still, I was so traumatized by the bug.
It exploded in your hand. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a natural reaction. I'm not using them. It's gonna take time to get rid of that.
The real question here is that this is still so weird when you wear civilian clothing. You can't even holster a gun, let alone put your grenades anywhere, as this guy shows. He's throwing the grenades in civilian clothing. Where is he taking them from? He's picked them up somewhere, probably.
He walked in with them, because you see his other hand has another grenade.
Yeah, well,
that's just all he's got is grenades.
This is a promo pick anyway, but it just make you wonder, like, okay, so how is that going to work? They surely will have to make something. Since they keep doing this, they surely will have to make some sort of a way where you can properly carry guns in civilian clothing and also stow them, holster, something that you can carry with you, like a part of a jacket that you can holster guns into. Actually, you can technically, some of the jackets have inventory sizes that you can carry a sidearm in, but you can't, equip it quickly, because you, in order to actually then do that, you'd have to go into the inventory and drag it into your hands. It's not like hitting one and you equip it, because it's not equipped, it's in your inventory at that point. So yeah. Methods for combat in civilian clothing. If they want that, then make it happen.
Give us holsters now. So, the next thing we can talk about is the number. Guess what number million? I'm thinking about. 4 million.
At least three.
At least three what?
Yes.
Well, the number's four. At least three.
At least three unique 3K or 3 mil unique players.
Plus all the bots, the people with secondary accounts.
At least three people who have gotten refunds.
That number would be much higher than that, I think.
That's why it's at least.
At max. So it's 4,600,205
accounts.
600 already now.
I'll go to funding.
What the hell? So we hit 4 million a couple days ago. And now it's 600,000 more.
No, sorry. 4,006,205.
6,000. Okay.
Did I say 600?
I don't know. I thought you did. Going crazy. I don't know.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. 4,602,006. Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
And so not that far from half a million, half a billion.
How about these shirts?
Oh yeah, these shirts. So I don't know. Was it you that popped it up?
I posted it, but I found it on Reddit. Some these blue and red ones already exist. They're in your hanger.
Or did they?
If you backed, they exist in your account.
Or do they? Because we're still waiting for them. So that's like back in 2015 or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's what it says. 2045, 2048.
So they didn't give us the 3 million one or the 4 million one yet?
No.
No, those aren't even. I should say this. These blue ones and the red one are official things that they've made. But this is just concept art by the looks of it. But these are attributed to anyone who's backed before the 2 million award for the red one and for the 1 million backer or account for the blue one. The green one and the purple one were made by some backer just recently because they hit 4 million. And he was like, oh yeah, just concepts on warships. Shirts.
Yeah.
And he made these. Yeah. And they're kind of like, it's a good,
nice,
cool idea. To just, yeah. But like I said, these first two shirts don't exist in the game yet.
No. I'm not sure why COG are dragging their heels in this one, but.
And it still says 245 here.
They're building Squadron 42.
Oh, please.
It takes priority. Even Todd Poppy was saying it.
Someone
he's
can
waiting
make
on
this
Squadron 42.
In an afternoon.
Okay. Yeah. Exactly.
Probably. I mean, that's probably a little real weird to say that way, and maybe not to be true, but
I mean, it depends if the art is done. Like, if the logo is already done, then yeah, it probably takes an hour to take a t-shirt that exists, turn it purple, and slap a logo on it. If they have to make the logo, then that's more time. But
It should be the design is the same, so it shouldn't take that long to do.
But it's two-tone, and you know they have to do proper material physics on the two different tones. They've got to calculate tear strength.
They have to make it like an animated thing on it or something. I bet you that might actually be what they were going to do with that.
It should also be an RFID chip so I can walk into the Million Mile High Club if I'm wearing the 1 million backer shirt.
That's not even remotely the same. You too bad.
So, Relum, the next one.
What?
What subscriber flow items would you like to find as rare loot?
Oh, fuck.
Because you replied to this, didn't you?
I did.
Yeah.
Now, we talked about this in one of the shows before, too.
Was this a Spectrum post that they said, what do you want to see?
No, Twitter. Or...
Oh.
So, yeah. The community... people post these Twitter now and again. Sometimes I think they don't really think before they post
they
it.
They don't. No.
So you ask these stupid questions all the time. And this is one of them. What subscriber flare item would you like to find as rare loot? And Relum answered the question correctly. None. Subscriber items should be rare. I mean, properly rare.
It's weird to get into because at the same time there's a lot of these people that a lot of the subscribers that have also been thinking about the fact that if you do lose them, since you paid money for them, will you be able to get them back? But technically I kept saying this before too. I mean, maybe there's some legal thing that doesn't allow them to take something away in game, because they paid actual money for it, which makes it a purchase. Yeah. So
it is a purchase. So
but at the same time, I feel like that should just be the case, that if you have a subscriber item and you're stupid enough to actually use it in the game, knowing that you could lose it, if you then lose it, I mean, I would be all for the fact that if you then if that happens, then it's gone until someone else finds it.
Do it the same way they do it in SWTOR. You have a merchant that sells you back all of your real money items for like 1 credit that you've lost.
Is that how they do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is probably, probably a legal thing that they had to add into the game.
So how do you stop it from being abused then?
You only get one.
One per account or something, yeah. Or how many times you've actually bought it.
If you lose it, you go and buy it again for one thing. But so you could give it to all your friends, but...
But that's what I'm trying to say. It would be a rare item then in that case.
Yep.
And so you could technically try to profit from it.
It would no longer be a rare item, because what would happen is I have fancy subscriber item. It's 1 credit. Oh, you want one of my fancy subscriber items? Let me drop it and go buy one for 1 credit. So it's not, they immediately become not rare.
But that shouldn't happen though, because you can make you can generate endless amounts of those things. You should either despawn the original one, then if you want to do it that way.
You could do it like that, but it depends on how you want to treat it, right? If you want to give other people the chance to loot those things off of your dead body, then
you can't buy it. At that point though.
No, you could still buy it because you spent real money on it. So you can still buy it back. But if you want to make it lootable, then it just will not be rare. If you want to make it not lootable, then it would be rare because only the people who bought it would have it. But if you looted it, it would just turn into the non-subscriber flare version of it or whatever.
Kind of already what it is, but...
It could make it quite difficult for you to claim it back. So let's say that you have to go to a vendor on the far side of the bloody system. Far side, or, 10 or 15 jumps away. And you have to go down to this dark kind of alleyway that's very awkward to get to.
Unless that changes every time you lose it, like that location, all you have to do is get there once and then everybody gather around while I drop these rare pistols on the ground for you to pick up.
It doesn't matter where it is.
I have to change, yeah. You would have to.
Another thing that would make that difficult is this game is kind of different than Sodor in that regard, that at least when how it's supposed to work, what Chris wants, is that everything is physical and everything is persistent, which means that if for whatever reason it does happen that you lose that subscriber bought item with actual money, it's not completely lost, unless maybe there's still some way to destroy items which makes them completely go away. But if it's if everything's persistent and you just lost it, it should stay there. So how can you then make it so that you can buy a new one again? That's just weird. At which point, if you do to be able to buy a new one, it would just deflate the rarity of that completely.
I mean, it's the same way you do it in, like, Eve with insurance or whatever. You mark it as abandoned, and then it's no longer yours, and you buy a new one.
Well, not only that, but it's all... MMOs does the same thing. You can't have infinite amount of things floating around. So there's a limit, and you can categorize it as how and when something was lost, how important is it, etc. So a coffee mug isn't as important as a custom gun, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
So it that will, but eventually the custom gun will also be too old and will be wiped from, if it's not claimed, possibly claimed. You know what I mean? So it's more about it's persistent in that, in if you look at persistency as you can die and go back, if you're someone that hasn't stolen it, you can pick it up. But anything beyond that point is a bonus. Eventually, an area fills up if there's too much. You know, it goes to a central file, where it's just a reference. But
I mean, actually,
that reference filter, reference holder will be purged as well.
Putting them on the loot table, like, one, I mean, I guess the devil's argument is nobody ever said they had to be rare. Like, just because you paid money for it, never guaranteed that they weren't going to just give it out for free one day. But two, I think they're kind of undercutting their sales here. I don't think there should be any item in the subscriber store that is functionally unique, where like the only way to get X pistol is through subscriber flare. But they or should like, be cosmetically unique.
And this gun was owned by General Grievous. You know what I mean? This gun was owned by this has a history. This gun has a unique paint job, etc.
Yeah, unique paint jobs are how you get people to spend money.
And history. You know, in-game fictional history.
I guess, but I don't think I've ever met anybody who bought a cosmetic because of its lore. But I'm sure that those people exist.
Yeah, they exist. Yeah. Oh, sure. Same thing is with rarity, really, for items.
Yeah, I think it's dumb that they're putting it on the loot table, but not because I'm worried about them being rare, just because I think, like, if you're going to have a subscriber store, make it cash only, and just put different colored versions of those things in the game. And then none of this matters, and people can stop complaining about being a special snowflake.
Decision probably most likely be based on some priority they might have on the income they have from those things when it comes to money.
Well, if they're adding it to the loot table, that's going to reduce sales, because why would I buy an armor pack for like $12, $15 when I can just go farm it?
Because you're backing the game.
Sure, but then put every item in the game in the cash shop at that point, right? Because at that point it's a skip the grind mechanic, which I'm fine with, but like...
Nah, that's too many items. No, as you said, it has to be different. So like paints, as we've seen in a lot of other games, paints is probably the best example. As you said again, it can't be functional items. But that has to be ultra rare, and that has to be non-buyable.
Just take it off the loot table. Just have a color that is on the loot table. First of all, I am of the opinion that paint palettes is a much better thing to sell than skins, or sell both of them, but like
unique colors, right?
No, like rather than selling
what do you mean combinations as in palette?
No, I mean like you can personally choose the color of your armor, you can paint it, but outside of like RGB, you can buy 40 colors on a paint palette, and then you can custom color your own armor. Like, I think it's dumb that the yellow version and the green version of two armors are two distinct items. Like, just let me change the color of it at a workbench or something.
I agree.
And if you want to charge me for the access to certain colors, like Warframe does that, and I think it's a great business model. Like, people will buy the color palettes for cheap.
The more shinier, the more metallic, the more money it should cost.
Sure. But
the more pink, just sticking with worldviews, anybody that's willing to wear pink are willing to pay more. CIG, if you listen, charge their asses.
Yeah, you get like 40 colors in Warframe for like $5, and it applies universally to every item in the game you can apply those colors to. But they release a new palette like once a quarter, and everybody buys them because it unlocks new fashion.
More.
You can more options. Like,
the
color of fuchsia on your left toe is now slightly more aligned to the rest of your outfit or whatever.
People want to be unique.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of people want to be unique. Let's put it like that.
Yeah. I'm okay with
them.
I'm okay with them releasing like cosmetically unique armor, like it has identical values and hitbox to other armors in the game. It's just it looks cosmetically different. Sell that for money. That's fine. And then let everybody custom color their shit and leave subscriber shit off the loot tables. Everybody wins.
Yeah. They're going to have to do that anyway.
Like we said in when they first did this, we were confused about this too. Although it was like a good way to test the inventory loots and create system. Because and we just thought that they did that back then because, you know, they may still be the case actually. They did that just because they had access to a large pool of items that weren't available in any of the shops yet. So the people had a reason to go around and look for the crates to test the system. Because if you just put stuff in the crates that is available in the shops of that or stuff that is not really that rare anyway, like other colors of the same armor piece, people wouldn't be doing that as much, I guess. So we felt it was just an easy way for them to populate the loot table with items that weren't previously available for at least not for loot.
On top of that, Realm, don't you think this is temporary? The way they do colors now, that eventually they will maybe even sell.
Don't know. That's
the ability to paint more specific.
If they were going to do that, they would have done it.
I thought they said they couldn't because it was restricted to 3 colors, wasn't it? Was that what they said? You can only have 3 colors.
Everything, this game couldn't be because they were restricted to 32-bit. They fixed that, didn't they? Every time they say that, you should say they haven't bothered to do that yet.
Haven't bothered you.
There was this same debate, though, about this when, I don't know when that was, not so long ago, that someone resurfaced that video that I probably would have to take too long to find right now. But there was a video from some episode of Around the Verse where they were messing with they were finally starting to make a system that they could use to skin the ships, paint them, and have different facets of the ship be different colors. And they had this reel of them showing all the different combinations they could make. And I'm not sure if this was actually mentioned in that episode, but people kept thinking that was how it was going to work, and that players would have freedom of choosing all these different sections of the ships to be a specific color, basically making it like Guild Wars 2 or something like that, where you can just paint sections of your armor different colors and you have freedom to do that within restricted that you have to earn the paints first or buy them from the cash shop or whatever. But eventually they started going with these paint systems, with these pre-configured paints that everyone could just obtain or buy or earn in other ways. Which was, you know, something that recently resurfaced when they thought, like, why didn't you do it this way?
But there's another catch in this, is that everything we do in-game right now costs a lot. It is just immense because of the load. Because we aren't on server meshing. And server meshing is also client meshing. So you go in your client, you are not loading everything. So suddenly you have a lot of resources to load a shit ton of different colors, of different shades, and different 3D objects, different metallic shines, etc. Shadows, all this can be dramatically enhanced for what the client can see. The same thing from how much different change can the server handle. So I think that there's a lot of cool shit that's not possible right now and not worth their time investing in doing right now until the server and the client has the capability to do this.
The 300 eye sales with the paint. Oh dear.
Yeah, they still have that, even though they said they don't like it.
There's so many things that they've done in the past that they probably regret, which currently makes it kind of into a mess, because the similar thing is with the whole thing that before they had paint system, they started occasionally releasing these special types of ships, like the Hornet, Heartseeker, and that Gladius variant that was basically just a different skin of a ship, but came with a different loadout, so it had different guns on it. But neither of which is something that you currently can't do yourself. Like, you can swap the guns out yourself and make it into a Gladius Valiant. The only thing you can't do currently is equip that skin, because it doesn't exist as a skin. It was just brought out as a special edition of that ship, which technically really isn't a variant. It's a special edition, kind of, like, because it's not different other than the paint and the loadout.
They rolled back those B-fucks real quick too,
and they should get rid of that system. But how do you even do that, because people have already bought them? So can they revert that, like the Gladius Valiant? Can they revert it so that they can make that paintable and just give the people that bought it the Gladius plus the paint and the parts?
Of course they can.
Yeah.
So why don't they?
I mean, I think they're going to have to do a great crunch, or whatever you want to call it, eventually, where they say, like, okay, here's how cosmetics actually work. Like, we've tried 30 things over the years. Here's how, quote-unquote, modularity and cosmetics actually work from this day going forward, and this is the permanent for now system. But yeah, I think they should just go with, you can choose colors, like you have color zones and you can choose colors, and they can still sell skins that give you different color zones on the same ship to then choose your colors on. Like, what if I want a hot pink camo? I don't want to buy a hot pink camo. I want to buy the color hot pink, and I want to buy a camo skin, and I want to color.
I think a dev would then say, I mean, you can see this coming because it's already kind of noticeable that there's so much more than just painting a ship a different color. And we've seen them go much further with that system as well, since they made ships like that... the alien ship, what's it called? And it had specific skins with this weird glare on it, which was kind of like that material that changes color based on what angle you're looking at it.
Yeah. I mean, that can be a paint job. I mean, you could apply that paint to any ship. That's not an issue.
And there's also a lot of different ways that you can see the how they gloss or glim or matte, have a matte version of the same, with the exact same color, probably. Which is current, a bit like this one on the top, like the Cutlass Ghoulish green had a very weird shim to it, shimmering.
Yeah, Warframe does the exact same thing. That's why they have a million color palettes.
Yeah, just have that available to the backers as well. But that would make it very...
Because you have a color palette that's...
more work.
Matte colors, then you have metallic colors, then you have light reactant colors, and each one of them is $5, $15, whatever you want to charge for it. Because the other thing is, right now, paints are physical items in the game. So you got to cart that shit around. And, like, if you want to change the color of your ship, you've got to have it in your inventory and equip it. And it's a terrible system. Hopefully, that's just temporary because they haven't built, like, a UI for it yet. But,
I don't know.
Like, they can win the best of both worlds here, where you sell skins and you sell colors and people buy both of them, because you can only color the zones of the skin that you're currently using.
But they're making money off of this.
Right. I think they would make more money the other way.
What is your point, like, Liam, sir?
No, I'm just showing you the difference.
Mercury has a lot of skins.
If you have the ghoulish green pack and they come out with a ghoulish blue, are you going to buy that? I wouldn't. If I have a green camo, it's like, ooh, do I really need to spend $15 more on a blue camo instead of a green camo?
But no, a lot of people would, because, you know, they got to collect everything and they all think that it's the only way to get it.
Right, but it's that like age-old question of lower amount of sales for a higher amount of money, or higher amount of sales for a lower amount of money, for a digital product that costs you no additional to sell more of. You would think you would want to sell as many of them as possible, and I think the way you do that is you sell a camouflage skin and let people color it, because then everybody's going to buy that. Who wants camouflage?
Iridescent. That's what you're looking for. That's the ones that change color depending on the light, the direction of the light. Yeah,
okay. What did you just call me?
Iridescent.
Got another thing coming. Only one problem.
Yeah, the Nomad has a few. I think the 600i has a few as well.
What are you gonna do now, bro?
Your buddy. But yeah, at the moment it's all about funding, and at the moment the current system is doing very well for CIG, because of suckers like me who has to keep buying them all.
Sucker.
Yeah, for your volunteer wiki. I thought you were an influencer. Shouldn't they give you all that shit for free?
Influencer.
God. An influencer. A Star Citizen influencer. That's hilarious.
My God. It's been TwitchCon has been happening in Amsterdam, and that's just the worst thing you could ever see, because they're a place full of self-centered streamers and their fans trying to get a glimpse of their quote idol, or whatever you want to call it. It's just... sometimes selling themselves for the money,
selling their soul.
I'll sell your soul.
What soul? I'm a hamster. Hamsters don't have any soul. I thought this was interesting.
What did you just old Reddit?
Because it's better than the new Reddit.
Is it?
Yeah.
Does it run better too?
Yes.
Doesn't work so well on my large screen.
Crusader 8 2. And yeah, it one shots an Idris.
How? Bomb?
With the Moab, yeah. I thought it was hilarious when I saw this.
Where did they get an Idris?
It's easy to get an Idris now.
Oh, the mission's in, isn't it? Yeah, I forgot about that.
But yeah, it dropped the bomb and bang. Which I'm now even more convinced that the Idris is so underpowered compared to what it I think it should be.
Well, I'm assuming that thing had its shields on, though, right?
You would expect so. I don't think you can turn the shields off.
Let's see. A bomb that... Yeah, but really, the bomb should be... Shouldn't the bomb be nerfed, too? Because really, the size of the explosion makes... It's cool and all. That's probably why they did it initially. But... Balance-wise, should it really be able to destroy so much in that radius? When there's something going on the ground and you're like, oh, just drop a bomb on it.
Yep, bombs go boom. They blow up all kinds of stuff.
You should stop the A2 from getting near its target.
Hell yeah, sure. Once it does hit, should the consequences really be that big?
Well, I'm still expecting the prices of these bombs to be horrendously expensive. And that also goes for, I think, ammo. I think ammo needs to be expensive. All missiles, rockets need to be expensive. If they're overpowered, then there needs to be some kind of money sink to compensate that you don't just spam them. The cost of running the A2 should be expensive as well.
So
everything should be expensive. Everything needs to be expensive. Inflation.
Inflation. Good. That's a depressing word.
Not if you use it as an adjective for boobs.
So this popped up again on Reddit. Apparently a former EA employee talks about basically bugs.
Oh.
And I thought this was... You can easily apply this to Star Citizen, obviously. But you explained it pretty nicely, actually, how game-breaking bugs were divided into four categories, A, B, and C, and D. And then when they bring out a patch, they completely ignore D, which is classified as minor, and A would be serious. And then the closer they got to the release, they just end up ignoring B, C, and D and just concentrate on the game-breaking ones. And then they release it.
That's basically what Top Happy was saying in Inside Star Citizen Live. He was talking about how they're trying to get rid of all of the game-breaker ones and get it to where it's playable. And then they push it out to PU.
But the idea of this is game-wide standard, really. The game industry standard. And people, still give out about Star Citizen, but this occurs practically in every game that comes out. It's rare that a game comes out completely bug-free.
Right, but they're comparing a released game to a game that's still in development, right? So that's why you get stuff like Cyberpunk, where it's absolute trash when it comes out, because they did exactly what this guy said. But Star Citizen, they're building the game and trying to squash bugs at the same time.
Which is futile, because the second you change the code, you introduce 30 more bugs.
Yep.
Yes.
Market is so full of other crap, really. It's just...
So, is the credibility of this project increasingly fading away?
Credibility?
No comment.
It never had credibility.
So,
why not?
This user, I love going to Spectrum and seeing the whinging that goes on there.
It's always been a scam in everybody's eyes.
Made further AI improvements. And that means it's all fixed?
Yeah, that's exactly it.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
That's again, the problem. Okay, yeah. Bye.
Again, so this is a classic example of a backer. And this is linked to the previous one that we've seen about the EA dev. The backers just don't understand at all game development, and yet they come out with these comments, you know, going, oh, you're not credible anymore because you never.
No, they are experts.
How many have we seen
developers? Because they watch all the videos that people make about how games are developed
from influencers that don't know how it works either.
How can you keep the faith in this project?
Oh, that's so weird. So,
I've written 3.5 lines of code in my life. I'm a game dev expert.
Yeah.
Have you?
Yeah.
Wow.
Cool.
That must be some special code that you made.
Must be working for CIG then. All right. Okay.
I mean, I solved all of CIG's problems. I'd finished server meshing like 6 to 8 years ago, but Chris Roberts was too busy sipping pina coladas on the beach and told me to trash it because he wasn't done raising money yet.
Maybe he was busy trying to buy the pina colada company.
It's all a scam. Chris Roberts is a lizard person.
Oh, is he? Oh, okay. Here's another one. I like the whingers.
Oh, we're gonna go whinging now.
We're near the end of the show. Why not?
Salt block.
So this is a guy who's given out about the Cutlass Red and the fact that it's now a useless ship. Why do we have it? Why do we need such ships? It was basically given out because when it was nerfed, if you can call it that.
It was nerfed, yeah.
I think we were spoiled in the first place by getting...
I said that was a big mistake, them doing that. Because this was the kind of situation you're going to end up with.
But does he have a point? What's the point of the Cutlass Red?
If you can, the point of the Cutlass Red is to do quick patch-ups, and then hopefully, if you can't get them back up and running, take them someplace where they could get... fixed, like an ambulance, right?
NPC missions. Problem is the point game, of the Cutlass Red.
The gameplay is not there. It's just, you can't, I mean, right now it's easy enough to just kill yourself and then just come back to wherever it was that you killed yourself. It's quicker and faster. There's no consequences.
It doesn't despawn.
Until the consequences are there and the actual gameplay is there, it really is useless, but it does serve a purpose. People keep forgetting the long game.
I mean, his second point is much more prescient is that when the medevac comes online, the Cutlass Red will be useless, except for
it's well over the price.
Again,
you could say that for every ship in the same category. Be like, but
I mean, but that's true of every ship in the same category. There is a best, there is a meta, and nothing else will be used. That's how it works in every game that has ever existed. There are 1,000 weapons in WoW that are dropped by 1,000 bosses, but only the best couple are used in every class. And the only reason it's not everybody using the exact same weapon is because drop rates.
Rarity. Yeah.
Right. Like, in a game like this, or a game like Eve, where the only object is money, that's preventing you from flying the quote-unquote best ship, the only people who will be using the worst ships are new players.
Poor people.
And poor people, yeah. People who are bad at the game or don't care about being competitive. People doing NPC missions or new players.
Oh, it's also usage cost difference, probably, right? So, not just spending the money on initially buying that thing.
Right, but if player... I mean, really, I can think of, like, two scenarios where player resurrection actually matters. One, they make Death of a Spaceman so painful that, like, you want to avoid it at all costs. And so getting resurrected in a ship is worth whatever money you're spending. Or two, you're in some sort of PvP battle where flying back is going to be detrimental to the PvP battle. So you want your pilots to be respawning as quickly as possible. And in both of those cases, money, again, is no object. So people will be flying the Cutlass, or not the Cutlass, the Apollo Medevac, because it can respawn in its one configuration. In its other configuration, it can hold, what, like 3 times as many injured people?
Yeah, but depending on the situation, like you're saying, you may not want to risk the Medevac.
It's the same size.
Well, no, it has the ability to...
Six tier one.
Six tier one.
4 tier 2s or 2 tier...
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Whatever.
Right.
You
either go, yeah. So if you have them set up for tier ones, tier threes, where it's like it's resurrection, you're not going to want to be near the front line with those things because those are, you know... Well, primary them, targets. Well, one so of them is like it almost makes sense to have a Cutlass to transport to where the Medevac is, than to bring in the Medevac and risk losing the tier three resurrection pods.
I mean, it also depends on how the mechanic works. Like, does somebody have to drag a body to the ship for it to be resurrected, or do you just get printed? Right, because again, you have to think about gameplay mechanics. Like,
yep.
It is not fun to sit there dead for 30 minutes while your friend drags your ass to a ship, right? It's the same thing with prison. Like, there's a reason they just teleport you around, because it's the same problem with bounty hunting. Like, you are not going to be in the back of someone's cargo hold for 12 hours while they go grocery shopping after they collected you in a bounty. You're going to get turned into an asset, and you, the player, is going to get teleported to prison, and the frozen version of you or whatever will just be in the back of their cargo hold as long as you want it, because it's not fun. And it can be trolled, right? So when you die, my guess is that you just die and you wake up instantly or within 30 seconds or a minute or whatever at the nearest spawn point that will accept you. And so if that's the case, again, there is no need for the ambulance. And the only reason you want to be transported in an ambulance, like, if death of a spaceman is so terrible, then maybe the ambulance is useful. But outside of death of a spaceman being like the worst thing in the universe that you absolutely never want to have happen, like, why would I spend 30 minutes waiting for Wee to get in his Cutlass Red and fly over to me because of both of my legs have been broken, probably by Wee, and then he has to pick me up, and then he has to fly me 30 minutes back to the hospital. I'm just going to kill myself, and I'll respawn on a planet, and it's going to be significantly faster, and I can go on with my day again because I don't have 12 hours to play this game every day. I have a job. I have a life. So,
because death of a spaceman, you lose a percentage of your stuff if you.
Oh no! I lose the shit I had on me. Look at Relum, for instance, who's got literal box loads full of gear.
Do I?
Like,
but yeah, that's because we can't sell it.
Sure, but the flip side of that is, okay, you can sell it. Now you have a bunches of credits that you could buy that gear with. Oh no, I've lost my armor set.
Yeah, but I mean, this is all valid points, but it's still very high level, because like you said, Relum has a ton of stuff, but if he wants that ton of stuff with him everywhere he goes, that's a major inconvenience and a major ship with loading all the stuff into it to move it and the risk of losing it.
Right.
And the same thing applies to people. If you're in the middle of a combat operation with people, sure, maybe it's better to drop to just die and respawn, providing that they have equipment waiting for you at the other end. But if they don't have equipment waiting for you at the other end, then you might want to wait those 30 minutes, if the battle lasts that long, to be resuscitated or fixed so that you can actually get back into combat with your equipment. Otherwise, you're going back naked. You know what I'm saying?
Right. I'm just thinking that really there's two scenarios when you boil it down, and there will always be people who do the inconvenient thing, or the role play thing, or the less than optimal thing. But realistically, either death is so important that money is no issue, in which case nobody uses the Cutlass Red and everybody uses the Apollo Medevac, because you do not want to die, and the Cutlass Red can't do that for you. Or nobody gives a shit about dying, and you don't use the Cutlass Red because nobody gives a shit about dying. So why would I go through this annoying medical gameplay when I can just put a bullet through my head? Yes, I lose. How much does a set of armor cost? 50 grand, maybe, tops. Maybe I fail the mission I'm on. Great. All of that is significantly more convenient than waiting for somebody to show up, if that's even a possibility, or like hoping that someone shows up because I put out a distress beacon, waiting that time, getting transported to a medical facility, doing that, and great, I didn't fail my mission, but now that took me an hour and now I have to go back and finish my mission. Oh shit, I broke my leg again. There goes another hour of my life, and all of a sudden, you know, the mission's taken me 7 hours to complete because I keep having to do this stupid medical loop. Like, it just doesn't make sense.
So the Cutlass Red is useless. Okay.
Yeah, I think so.
It's got nice flashy lights.
I think it'll be great for NPC missions. I think that's primarily what it's going to be used for. Like a lot of things in this game, where they don't make sense in PvP, or they don't make sense when you are discussing player interactions. But they make tons of sense for NPC missions. Transport patients, transport organs from X location to Y location for X credits. You need an ambulance with organ storage facilities. Great, perfect, great mission. Requires ship usage. The Cutlass Red's entry level, so, and relatively fast, so people will use that as a courier. Great. But if I'm doing this, if I'm in a bunker shooting people, I'm just parking in an Apollo medevac outside. That way, if I die, I just walk out of my ship brand new with a new set of armor, walk in here, kill people again, pick up my dead body and carry on with my life.
Well, see, this is the thing that we haven't really seen the medical gameplay properly introduced. So I guarantee you that you will not be able to do that yourself. You will need somebody else to do that. Because they'll definitely introduce some kind of gameplay where you have to twist a few knobs or change a few levels or whatever. You know, they'll have to.
No, they don't.
They've done this to everything. Look at refueling; it's not straightforward. So they'll make it semi complicated. Therefore, it will require something else.
It's not complicated now. Now you just have to pick where you want to respawn. That's it. Think they make healing complicated. You have to be careful with the drugs and all that other stuff. But for respawning, it's just like.
What he said is to put his medevac outside and go into these missions all on its own, at which point you assume that you can just respawn on your ship and heal yourself alone, but that might not be the case. It's possible that you can still respawn in a ship like that has a respawn point, but you will still be in your bed. Severely
dead,
limited,
and be up to the another player to heal you.
It's possible.
I get it. Yeah, I get it. I don't know if they'd do that though. The biggest risk is leaving your ship out there alone.
But you can still have the option to then be like, okay, I won't respawn at my ship, but at a hospital with NPCs that can then heal me. You know, because that's the other option, and so you still can't do it alone.
But the thing is if you're respawning, you're spawning in a brand new body. There's nothing to heal because the original body's back where.
No,
you left
they did
it.
Say that regeneration would still have lingering effects, though, right?
Yeah, like memory loss and some other stupid shit.
Yeah, it's a little unclear though.
Wait, was that a player?
No, there's
an NPC.
Civilians that are just.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Hiding.
Oh,
yeah.
Ooh,
but that's a drug lab, right? So you can just as easily kill them. It wouldn't matter.
I don't know. The drug requires that for it.
Oh, you do?
I don't know. I haven't tried. Maybe I was afraid I
would. Are you playing live? You should try it.
I never did that.
We're game testing. We need to know these things.
I haven't been game testing this in some time.
What, in a couple of days? More like.
Oh, no, I mean actual testing.
Oh, testing though.
Yeah, like. I'm gonna grab my notepad and note down all the things.
Yeah, no, I haven't done that myself either. I've been slacking.
Let alone do that in live. I don't think it's really intended for that either. You can, and there is an issue council for live. And it's not like I'm not saying that it's not looked at all. I mean, it's there, so it's being looked at, but. most of the testing occurs in the PTF phases, specifically the Evocati wave and the wave one, probably. That's where the issue counter matters the most. The bugs that people report.
God, I hate the NPCs.
Have you guys tried Orison?
Orison what?
No. No, it's
the Orison mission.
No.
I'm glad it was a bug fest.
Actually, I saw some gameplay today, and the NPCs were kicking their ass.
Okay. And they must have got a good connection then.
Or not.
Is this live, bro?
No. Looty, looty, loot.
Did you ever get a big box?
Big box? No, you never get those.
I thought you could if you blew up your ship.
Yeah, but they don't occur.
They don't stick around very long either. They get buggy sometimes and despawn and lose everything anyway.
Well, if you keep them in your ship, they do though. But no, those bigger boxes don't occur in as loot crates. They don't do that yet.
Hopefully, with the cargo refactor, we'll be able to get the big ones and buy them.
Yeah, we should get that in 5 years' time, yeah.
Because we can only buy the small ones right now, which really sucks.
Yeah, those are smaller than backpacks, like useless.
Yeah, they are absolutely useless.
What we really need is to have a cart on wheels that you can bring down. Place all your shit onto. Fix the boxes.
Wait, can't you grab some carts from some of the hangars?
No. That was probably the idea with those things. But
use the tractor beam to put it into your ship?
No, you can't even tractor beam those carts. You can push them, but they won't go further than the gates or something. They won't allow you to take them. Which was, I mean, I guess it was intended to do that, but I mean, they probably broke the server because people kept leaving all the crap everywhere. They still do anyway. How many times have you seen gurneys outside of the clinics on the floor?
Yep.
On the space stations.
I'll tell you, I would fly down to these places, and instead of going down into the bunkers, I'd be grabbing the freight containers and say, let's see what we got.
Yeah, I was surprised even that when they implemented those loot crates things that there's nothing outside here. Because it would be cool to search through this stuff as well, because it definitely is lots of stuff you could put out here.
Yeah, eventually.
There's even outposts that have some of these shanty buildings around them. Look like they actually have doors.
I would ransack that shit and avoid the gunfight. Hope for something.
Yeah, it's... No, this is pre-recorded. What's that? VCQBR. Oh, wow. But we're about to leave anyway, right?
Yeah. See ya.
It's after 10.
Bye, Felicia.
Who's Felicia?
You're Felicia.
That's not nice.
What's not nice about being Felicia?
So, in the week messages, is there anything? I suppose the foundation's still going on, so that's going on until the 25th. Try to take part of that. You might get a free beanie. Yee-hee.
Do you think
and a hat.
PTU go live?
It looks, I'm going to say yes for next Monday.
This coming Monday, like tomorrow Monday, no, or next Monday?
The Monday after, yeah. So if Aaron and Chris said it's 7 to 10 days, that was yesterday or day before. So yeah, I do expect it before next Monday.
Yeah, it was Saturday during the Australian Bar Citizen.
Yeah, we're all the way in Australia.
Aussie, Aussie.
Oi, oi, oi.
No, they were in Manchester.
Oh,
they're out.
They were invited to go, but they said, "Sorry, we can't join you."
Yeah. No, there was this Manchester company summer thing picnic they were having for the whole company.
Picnic.
Yep. Picnic.
That's nice.
Yeah, it was nice. Good weather for it, at least.
If I was a lizard person, I would never want to leave either.
So I do expect the Centurion even. So I do expect that for sale next weekend.
Didn't they say there was like two ships or two things done?
No.
In the roadmap. And then so one of them is the Centurion. Do you think they're going to drop something else?
No. God, no. No, Centurion will tie them over for the time being. What's this?
No, nothing.
So you don't see those anymore.
Rare, yeah. I was gonna really see them anymore.
It's not really that rare. Well, they used to be common. Yeah, everybody used to have it, and then
I wonder if they
still have them. But those people don't.
Can you sell them? Can you melt those?
Yes, you can melt it, No, you can't melt it. You can use it for upgrading.
You can upgrade it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so I wonder if a lot of people have used theirs to upgrade and stuff.
So I think it's worth $50. So it's a good start if you still have one of these.
You could buy these coats for $15 at one point.
Yeah, you can't find them anymore though.
No, no. It's kind of cool.
What else is there? That's basically it, really.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So VC says that you can melt it, but you can't get it back after if you do. And he still has his. He uses it to get around between the stations.
Yeah, because there would never be an upgrade to an Omega because that was it's a done
deal.
That
was a rare.
Yeah.
Yep. It's the same with the Raven.
Yep.
Yeah. But the it's my main package. So I can't
wonder. I wonder if they're going to do another thing like that. They'll some kind of ship with some kind of electronic equipment.
Well, they've done the AMD, they've done the Intel. Who's left?
There's Micron.
Amazon.
God, no. God, no.
Microsoft.
They're already partners with Amazon, right? So,
yeah.
Pretty much, yeah.
It'll be a new land vehicle. It'll cut down trees.
Yeah, but it was a hardware thing, right? So you got the AMD when you bought a video card. You got the Raven mm-hmm. when you bought the hard drive. Not the hard drive, the drive, SSD. Whatever, the uptime.
Yeah, you'll get the lumber yard when you spend $2,000 on Amazon.
Well, actually, most people got the AMD one through Alienware. Alienware were giving away thousands of codes on their website. That's how I got mine.
Ah.
Idris N comes with Tesla V100 GPUs. They're only $9,000 a pop.
Only.
And it comes with a Tesla cannon on the front of it instead of a real gun.
It costs her several thousand to repair it.
Ooh, you know, I heard that NVIDIA ordered a whole bunch of chips for their cards. And when the Bitcoin market bottomed out and everybody started selling all their video cards and stuff, they now have a massive surplus and they can't get rid of it. They are contractually obligated to still purchase all those chipsets and stuff. So maybe they can do some kind of deal with Star Citizen where they'll sell the video cards with a spaceship.
Or they just back China invading Taiwan and they don't have to buy the chips anymore.
Yeah, that's true too. But there you go, CIG. Help NVIDIA out. Make up a ship. Help them sell their cards that they have way too many of.
Green Idris N. I don't know if I fancy that. Bright green. Anyway.
All right. Anyway. Let's go.
Another week.
Another week. Over. Goodbye. It's it. We're out.
I love our exits.
At least, no, I shouldn't bring this up. Never mind. Let's go. Goodbye.
Okay.
I support the monkeys. Do you? Check out The Base. 24/7 online radio.
Oh, yeah.
Visit us at thebase.sc. They're professionals. Check out The Base.